Hello everyone, welcome back to my reinforcement learning course. This is our 9th lecture and today we will cover a very important topic, policy gradient methods. Here is the roadmap of our course. After a long journey, we have reached this point. Chapter 9. We are now nearing the end of the course. However, nearing the end does not mean the content is any less important. On the contrary, the topics we will discuss are becoming increasingly important. Why? Because the policy gradient method, along with the actor-critic method that we will introduce in the next lecture, represents the most popular methods in modern reinforcement learning. What is the connection between this lecture and the last one? In the previous lecture, we introduced value function methods. Previously, we represented values using tables. Now we can represent them using functions. This lecture is based on a similar idea. Previously, we used tables to represent policies. Now we can use functions to represent policies. There is a leap from the last lecture to this one. All the methods we have discussed so far are known as value-based methods. In contrast, the methods introduced today in this lecture, as well as in the next lecture, are policy-based methods. What does this mean? A value-based method aims to optimize a metric that is a function of values. By contrast, a policy-based method directly optimizes a metric that is a function of policies. By the way, the actor-critic method that will be introduced next time is another highly important method. It combines the policy gradient method with the value function method. This is what I said just now, and I won't repeat it here. Here is the outline for today's lecture. First, I will introduce the basic idea of policy gradient methods. In fact, its core idea is very simple. This simplicity will be reflected in sections 2, 3, and 4. First, we will define a metric for optimization. This metric is used to determine which policies are optimal. Once we have this metric, the next step is to optimize it. How do we optimize it? The simplest way is to use the method of gradient ascent. Since our goal is to maximize this metric, we apply gradient ascent. If the goal were to minimize it, we would use gradient descent. To apply gradient-based methods, the first step is to calculate the gradient of the metric. Afterward, I will introduce the gradient ascent algorithm. Specifically, we will present a well-known algorithm called reinforce. This is one of the earliest policy gradient algorithms. Based on this algorithm, we can extend and derive many other popular methods that are widely used today. Let's first introduce the basic idea of the policy gradient method. Up until now, all our policies have been represented by tables. For example, I have a set of states with each state corresponding to a row. I also have a set of actions with each action corresponding to a column. If I want to find the probability of taking action A3 in a given state, I can simply look it up in the table. So, all the policies we've discussed so far have been represented by tables. The basic operations of a table are quite simple. If we want to access a value or change a value, we can do so directly. Now, we will replace the table with a function. This means the notation for the policy, pi, will also change. It is still similar to before, but the difference is that now there's an additional theta. This theta is a vector, which represents the parameters of the function pi. The most commonly used form of this function today is a neural network. For example, here's a neural network with parameters theta. The input to the network is a state S, and the output is the probability distribution over all possible actions. For instance, pi a 1 s theta through pi a 5 s theta, assuming there are 5 actions. Previously, when we introduced value functions, we used w to represent the parameters of the value function. Now for policy functions, we use theta to represent the parameters. The benefit of replacing a table with a function is similar to what we discussed with value function methods. For instance, if the state space is very large or even continuous with infinitely many states, the tabular representation becomes impractical. This issue manifests in two ways. First, in terms of storage, I may need to store a large number of values. Second, in terms of generalization ability, the function representation performs better. Let me briefly explain what generalization means in this context. For example, if I want to update pi as with a table, I need to directly access both s and a to update pi as. However, with a function, this is not necessary. If I update one entry, say sa, the neighboring entry, say S prime, A prime, will also be updated. This is because when I modify the parameters of the function, it will simultaneously adjust the values for nearby states and actions. This means that by using fewer data points and less direct access, I can still achieve better results. This is what we refer to as generalization. Moreover, the form of the policy function, pi, can vary. Here I've written it in this way, but you could also remove the vertical bar or move theta to the subscript. Now let's formally compare the difference between tabular and function representations. As we just mentioned, there are three key points. The first difference is how we define optimal policies. If the policy is represented by a table, do you remember the definition of an optimal policy? An optimal policy pi star is defined such that for every state s, the state value v pi star s corresponding to the optimal policy must be greater than or equal to v pi s for any other policy pi. In other words, the state value of pi star should be greater than that of all other policies. However, when policies are represented as functions, the definition of optimal policies is different. In particular, a policy is optimal if it can optimize a scalar metric. What exactly this scalar metric is will be introduced soon. So, because the definition of optimal policies differs, it leads to many other differences. The second difference is how we access the probability of an action. When we use a table, if I want to find the probability of taking action A in state S, I simply look it up in the table. It's very straightforward. Now, it's still quite simple, but slightly more complicated. Since it's not a table, I can't directly look it up. I need to calculate it. For instance, if I'm using a neural network, I input the state S and let the network propagate forward to obtain the outputs pi A1 S theta through pi A5 S theta. The third difference is similar to the second, but it is about how we update policies. When represented by a table, as we discussed before, a policy pi can be updated by directly changing the entries in the table. It's very straightforward. But when represented by a parameterized function, this is not the case. Once the structure of the function is fixed, the function is purely represented by the parameters theta. If we want to change pi as, we cannot directly change it to a new value. We can only change pi as indirectly by adjusting theta. These are the three basic differences between using a table and using a function. Now let's see the basic idea behind policy gradient methods. First, we need an objective function to define what the optimal policy is. Here, we use j theta as the objective function. What exactly this function is will be explained in detail later. The parameter theta corresponds to the policy. Different policies represented by different values of theta will result in different values of j theta. Our goal is to maximize j theta. The optimal theta, denoted as theta star, should satisfy theta star equals argmax j theta. Once we have the objective function, we can optimize it. The simplest optimization algorithm is based on gradients, which is the following update rule. Theta at time t plus 1 equals theta at time t plus alpha times the gradient of j with respect to theta at time t. So, the overall approach is quite straightforward. However, you will see some complicated aspects. The first complicated aspect is about what metrics should be used. As you will see, it will take some time for you to understand the metrics. The second complicated aspect is about how to calculate the gradients of the metrics. You will learn a very famous theorem that can tell us how to calculate the gradients. This aspect also requires some time to learn. All these aspects will be covered in detail in today's lecture.